People have been telling me to get a bigger monitor, so I did. This is an Eizo, I don't know how to pronounce that name, FlexScan L771, 19.6 inch class color LCD monitor, viewable image size 19.5 inches. I don't know why that 1/10 of an inch makes that big of a difference that they have to specify it. I guess they were trying to compare it to 20 inch CRT monitors. This is from 2001, so it's 13 years old, works perfectly, bought it for 11 bucks at a thrift store. And it is big. You can see how thick it is and how many vents it has on the top and sides. On this side you get a hardware on-off switch. On the back it has two VGA inputs, so you can connect it to two computers and switch back and forth. There's the information sticker, made in February 2001 in Japan. Right now that's in 1024 by 768 resolution, but if I open up my ThinkPad, it readjusts itself to 1600 by 1200, which is the native resolution of this panel. You can see I can go all the way from 800 by 600 to 1280 by 720. I assume that will stretch it out, so the aspect ratio will be wrong. So it does not letterbox it. 1280 by 1024, pretty typical resolution for 17 inch monitors. But we can do 1400 by 1050 and 1440 by 900, which is probably also squished out like that. And finally 1600 by 1200, which is kind of pushing the limits of what analog VGA can do, but it's not too bad. It's a little bit fuzzy on the little text, but it's readable. Actually, it looks better in the center than it does off to the side, so it probably needs to have there's some kind of moiré pattern setting or something like that where you can adjust the phase of the pixels to align them better. I just did the automatic adjustment. So if you go on the web, some websites do a good job of adjusting themselves to take up the space. Others do not. Like Vaughn Live has all this blank space here, even on this big of a resolution. Typical V-Bulletin forum fills up the screen just fine. But my website obviously does not, because it was originally designed for 800 by 600. So it's pretty much fixed to that resolution, at least on the main menu. I think if I go into one of the other pages, then it fills up the screen. Here are the on-screen menus, and this thing even has a little built-in beeper. I found an original review of this monitor from PC Magazine in 2001. Anyone want to wager a guess of what the original list price was for this monitor? And the obvious reason why CRTs hung on for quite a while, even after LCDs were available. Here you go. MSRP $5,500. So needless to say, that's the reason why not too many people bought this kind of monitor back in 2001. But PC Magazine said image quality was excellent. No problems with color tracking. It was also available in black, but this one is the beige version, which looks better with vintage PCs like that. They said if you can afford it, the Eizo Naneo, doesn't say Naneo on it, but I guess they were merged at that point. FlexScan L771 is one of the largest and sharpest displays you can put on your desktop. And I forgot to show it because it's underneath and I can't get the camera under there. But this also has a built-in 4-point USB hub, and I'm surprised to find out that it's USB 2.0 rated. Although this one says rotates the portrait or landscape view. Well, this one, unless there's some kind of lock on it or something, doesn't seem to rotate. So that must have been a different version of it or something. Or that's because they have that special stand on it. Well, this one just has the standard desktop stand. For those who care about the specs, it's rated at a contrast ratio of 300:1. The brightness is rated at 200 nits. And needless to say, this is not a good monitor for gamers because it has a response time of 45 milliseconds. I believe modern LCDs are down to under 5 milliseconds. Also a viewing angle of 150 degrees horizontal and vertical. And it can support up to 75 hertz refresh rate at 1600 by 1200. Right now I'm running at 60 hertz. So it can do 27 to 94 kilohertz horizontal, 50 to 85 hertz vertical. So unfortunately it can't sink down to 15.75 kilohertz for things like Amigas and Atari STs and Apple II GSs. But here it says USB standard 1.1, so I don't know. Not that I'm going to actually use the USB hub that's built in, but as of now I don't know whether it's 2.0 or 1.1. It's an odd quirk. I discovered that if I close the lid of my ThinkPad, even though the built-in LCD is not active, it switches the external display down to 1024 by 768, which is the native resolution of this LCD. So let's see if it can do that on the fly and sort of rearrange things to fit the different resolution. So let me close the LCD. Yeah, it was able to readjust itself. So now if I open that again, it'll readjust itself to the higher resolution. This monitor was actually sitting on the floor of the thrift store for a couple weeks. There was several times I went in there before and I sort of looked at it, but I passed on it. Except today they had a 25% off sale, so the sticker price of $14.99 went down to around $11. So I think that's a pretty good deal, considering that the original list price was $5,500. And so far it's working perfectly as a nice, sharp, bright, colorful image. Absolutely no problems. Didn't even have to adjust the controls. I just hit the automatic button and it looks fine. So I know I've said it in a previous video, but these older LCDs that were the first ones to really come out in the late 90s and early 2000s are actually lasting longer than the ones from the mid-2000s, which had all those capacitor problems. Even as new as around 2010, I've seen monitors and TVs which have died due to bad capacitors. While this one from 2001 is still working perfectly fine.